What an interesting week it was this past week, wasn't it? And I was just in the 10:45 service, and I asked all the kids, how many of you are excited that school is out this week? And every single child went, and I said, how many of you parents were excited that your kids were out? Not one hand was raised. I couldn't believe it. Shocked. I asked everyone who's excited about going back. No kid raised their hand, and every parent in the room went. But it was an interesting week. Yeah, school being closed all week long. Some of you probably had at least one or two days off from work because of the snow. The church closed. We didn't have Ash Wednesday. I mean, that's unheard of in the Lutheran church. For good reasons, we didn't have it, safety reasons. But we had to cancel that because of the weather. And it is funny how just 4 inches of snow will do this. We have some really good friends of ours who are, he's a pastor in Fairbanks, actually Pastor Keenert's old congregation, and we told them that the 4 to 6 inches, she just went, it has to be -5 for the schools to cancel here. And Heidi and I were ashamed. We felt like wimps. But, you know, a little bit of snow does that here. And it makes for an interesting week when that happens. But I had an interesting week beyond just the snow this week. I slept on the couch every single night this week. And I was not in trouble with Heidi, in case you're wondering. That was not the reason why. I've been having some trouble sleeping, and so my doctor ordered a sleep test. And it was a very interesting contraption. If you've never taken a sleep test, it's really just amusing to look at yourself in the mirror, because you get this little thing that goes around your ears and goes underneath your nose, and you get an oxygen thing for your finger, and a band midsection and something here. It's not terribly comfortable, okay? And it looks really funny. Every single time Addie saw me with it, she just went, ha! And she still wants me to put it back on, even though we sent it back now. But it's an uncomfortable thing. I had to do it for 3 nights. And the first 2 nights I put it on, I really paid attention. I did it correctly. I put it on very tightly and made sure everything worked well. The first 2 nights went very well. The third night I decided I got cocky. I got cocky about a sleep test. How pathetic is that? But I thought, I got this figured out. And I just kind of slapped it on and got ready to go. And I woke up in the middle of the night with the nose piece on my forehead, the midsection band on my waist, and the thing on my arm on the ground. And I ended up having to do a sleep test for a fourth night because of that. But I learned something there. You can't just go to sleep and everything will work right. Even something as simple as that, you have to prepare correctly. You have to make sure it's on there correctly, because if you don't, then you really won't get the full benefits of that test if it's not on there correctly. And really, that's kind of what's going on at Lent for us as well. Lent is a time of season for us to refocus, to prepare, to look forward to the cross and the empty tomb. It's a great season for us as a church. And I will say this, if you don't take that time during Lent to refocus and to prepare and to draw closer to God, then the blessings of forgiveness and grace and mercy that are yours to the cross will still be yours, but you'll be missing something. You'll have missed the benefit of taking that time to refocus and prepare and really observe the Lenten season. And this idea of preparing and refocusing your heart on God is not something that has just started happening in the last year on Ash Wednesday, or the last 50 years, or 100 years, or 500 years. The entire idea of stopping, refocusing, and preparing your heart to draw closer to God is a constant theme throughout the Scriptures. Even this week in the story, chapter 21 of the story, with Nehemiah, we see this happening. Nehemiah gets the horrible news that Jerusalem is unprotected. The walls are torn down, and enemies are invading the city over and over again, and the people can do nothing to protect themselves. And Nehemiah says, no, this is not good enough. And he decides he's going to go to Jerusalem, repair the wall, and help the people become safe. The thing that's interesting about this is that he doesn't just haphazardly decide one day, I'm going to go. He prepares. He goes to the king. He gets the king's approval. He gets the king to write a letter. He gets the resources he's going to need to build that wall. But even before he did that, what did he do? He fell on his knees and he prayed. Before he even made up the decision of going there and how he was going to do it, he fell on his knees, he refocused his heart on God, and he cried out to him. And even later on in his story, the story of Nehemiah, the same thing happens. The people of Israel are being killed while they're building the walls by their enemies. And Nehemiah devises a plan of how this is going to do, how he's going to combat that. But even before he does that, he falls on his knees and he refocuses his heart on God. And really, that's the entire story of the Old Testament. God calling people for himself, where through them he will redeem the world. And yet people continually fall astray and fall aside. And God has to refocus them, call them back in, preparing their hearts, preparing his people, preparing the world for when the king would finally come, the king who would establish his kingdom forever, where peace and joy and harmony will reign for all eternity. He was preparing his people and the world for that, calling them to refocus their hearts on him, to turn back to him. And yet over and over again, the people fell short. But still, God kept his promises to them, because he sent a king. He sent that king that would establish his throne forever. And in today's gospel lesson, we see that king. We see Jesus here on earth. And this is, you know, I've read this story many times, but this is really, this past week as I've prepared this sermon, this has become one of my favorite stories in all the Bible. This story from Luke chapter 7 that we read today. It is an amazing story. The love that Jesus shows and the compassion that Jesus shows, but the lessons we can learn from this woman as well. It's really a fascinating story. Jesus is at dinner with the Pharisees. A Pharisee invites him in, and this is not terribly uncommon. Jesus had dinner with Pharisees, with tax collectors, and with sinners, and basically anybody who wanted to have the time to sit down and talk to Jesus, he wanted to sit down and talk to. And so he gets to dinner with this Pharisee, and as they're sitting there getting ready to eat, all of a sudden this woman comes in, and this is shocking. We got to remember, in the context of this time, women are second-class citizens. Thankfully, times have changed, but in the context of when Jesus had his ministry, women were secondary citizens. And this woman didn't have any connection to the men in that room, at least any connection that anyone would acknowledge. She's not his daughter. She's not a spouse. She's not a servant. She has no right or reason to be in the room with those men. And yet she comes in. And what's even worse is it's not just that she's a woman. She's a prostitute. She's the worst of the worst. She is a sinner. And yet she busts into the room and falls at the feet of Jesus. And tears pour out, and they're tears of sorrow. And these are, I do not believe these are tears of joy. She's crying. Tears of sorrow over her own sinfulness. But with her tears, she washes, she grabs her hair and begins to wash his feet with her hair. And she brings out this very expensive perfume, which she probably used in her profession. And she pours all that on the feet of Jesus, anointing him. It's an amazing story because this woman has no business being there, but nothing is going to hold her back from being in the presence of Jesus. No social conventions, no mockery, no fear, nothing is going to hold her back from being in the presence of Jesus. And she doesn't, it's important for us to know this, she doesn't know what he's going to say. For all she knows, he could just kick her aside and say, get out of here, what are you doing? She doesn't know the result of what's going to happen here, but she has to be there. She has to be in his presence. And she comes humiliating herself, humbling herself in the greatest way, and falls down at her feet, even though she doesn't say any words. In this action, it's humility, it's repentance, it's a cry for grace and mercy and love. And you know what's amazing is how Jesus responds, especially with everyone else in the room there. is everyone else in the room is appalled. And you can kind of see, what is wrong with Jesus? What is wrong with him? Doesn't he know who she is? If he was really a prophet, he'd know. What is wrong with him? He'd take her away if he knew who she was. Then everyone is appalled and disgusted at her and at Jesus. And then Jesus, though, responds beautifully. He welcomes her. And I love this painting, this artwork that was done this week. Because in this, we see, what is Jesus doing? He's wrapping his arms around her. He's embracing her. In her brokenness, in her simpleness, in her complete lack of anything of worth in the world's eyes, Jesus picks her up and embraces her. And he tells this wonderful story about forgiveness. He says he who's been loved, he who's been forgiven little, loves little. He who's been forgiven much, loves much. And this woman, her sins are forgiven. He tells her, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. It is a wonderful, wonderful story. That, as I said, I think I've never really understood the scope and the magnitude of how beautiful the story of forgiveness is that Jesus has for this woman here. But as I read this story, I am realizing this woman refocused her heart. She'd been living a simple life, and yet she came and refocused her heart on Jesus, on the Savior of the world. And he forgave her. She wanted nothing more than be in his presence, doing whatever it took to get there, regardless of what would happen to her. And I was convicted, honestly, as I was thinking about that this week. Because I think there's a lot of times in my life where I'm not so desperate as this woman is. There's a lot of times in my life where I get so busy with everything else that, I have kids, I have ministry to do here, I have hobbies I'm interested in, I have other family, I have sleep tests to do every night. I have other things going on, I get so caught up in everything else that I become complacent, and I don't really care if I'm in the presence of God or not. And my guess is that I'm not alone in that. But I was convicted because I realized I need to be desperately seeking Christ just like this woman was. And not just on Sunday mornings. I will say, I think it's great you are all here because the fact that you're here shows that at some level, every one of you is seeking to be in his presence. At some level. But the truth of the matter is, it should not just be on Sunday mornings. We should be seeking to be in his presence every moment of every day. With how we treat each other, with how we treat our coworkers, with how we deal with situations in our life, with how we treat our family. Every single thing in our life should be seeking how we can be in God's presence. And this Lenten season's wonderful because even though we fall short on that, we are able to look and remember the forgiveness that is given to us, but we're also given the opportunity to slow down, to refocus, to desperately seek to be in the presence of God, to come before him in humiliation, broken, and say, God, I have to be in your presence. I have to be in your presence, and no matter what may happen, when I'm with you, I know you will make all things right. The season of Lent is a time for us to refocus our hearts on that. It's a time for us to desperately seek God and prepare our hearts by coming before him in prayer, just like Nehemiah did. Coming before him in prayer and taking that time. I challenge you to take 10 minutes a day where you sit down every single day and late. 10 minutes a day where you sit down and pray. And you don't have to, I'm not just talking about just speaking for 10 minutes, but sit down and listen to God speak to you. Just 10 minutes to be in his presence every day. Take time during this Lenten season to prepare our hearts by repenting, by coming before God and saying, God, I know I am like this woman in this story. I know I'm a filthy, worthless sinner, but I need your grace and forgiveness. And to not just do that on Sunday mornings, but to do that every day. to prepare your hearts and refocus on God by fasting. You know, we give Lent a lot of times. A lot of people do that. And, you know, sometimes it just turns into a fun thing. Well, I'm giving up chocolate for Lent. Or I'm giving up eating vegetables for Lent. That was my older brother's thing always. I'm giving up eating vegetables. But you know what? It really is something important to fast, to give something important to you. And when you give that thing up, the time that you would spend with it, instead of spending it with that thing you are fasting from, to spend it with God. Prepare your hearts and refocus on God by living in humility and service during this season. Because this is a season where we know the end story. We see the cross where life and salvation was given to us because Christ took our death upon himself. And we see the empty tomb and know that we will not remain in a tomb either because Christ has come to set us free. We take this time to refocus, to draw near, to prepare our hearts. And when that celebration of Easter comes, when we have done this, it'll be that much more joyous, that much more wonderful. So prepare your hearts. Refocus on God. Desperately seek him this Lenten season. Amen. And now may that God of grace and mercy, who welcomed the sinful woman, embraced her, who embraced you and me as well, be with you and abide with you always. Amen.